Hi, everybody. I bet I did something on Memorial Day that nobody else, that I can't imagine that anybody else did. We had gotten all of our things done, going to the cemetery, going to a couple of family things, and Monday, Memorial Day, was going to be just kind of a kickback day. A neighbor called. He had something flopping around in his backyard. He had no idea what it was. He called my husband. I didn't know any of this was going on till my husband leaves the house, comes back, is knocking on the door, saying, "Could you get me a cup of water?" So I'm like, okay, he's thirsty. And I took the water out to him, and I went outside, and what the neighbor had in his shrub was a bird. And an injured bird. So we kind of had a discussion, you know, what kind of bird is it? What do we do? And thank heaven I'm surrounded by law enforcement, attorneys. I guess maybe they've kept me out of trouble over the years. My husband immediately launches into the legality of having the bird. There's the Migratory Bird Act. Of course there is. Of course there is some federal law that I have surely got to find a way to be in violation of. But I do think most laws, including that one, there's the letter of the law and there's the spirit of the law. And sometimes I think the two get a little confused. But anyway, he launched off into that because, you know, we can't keep the bird, we can't take care of the bird, it's illegal for us to have the bird, which I knew we weren't supposed to have the bird, but I didn't ask the bird to get injured and have the neighbor call me or call my husband. And so we have a cage, of course we do, we are always rescuing something, and we put him in a cage. And then in the interim, there had been a call to the neighbor, another neighbor, and he just happened to know an individual who was employed by a local avian research center. So we called, he called that gentleman, who, of course, it's Memorial Day. It's Memorial Day. People aren't at work. People are expecting to have a nice, quiet holiday weekend. But he was kind enough to come over. He examined the bird. It had a compound fracture of its wing, which was not a good thing. Birds have almost like bamboo sort of bones in their wings, not like our bones. And so when they fracture, they don't just break a clean break, they splinter. And so then trying to put those pieces back together is difficult to do. And then the location of the wound was not a good location of the break. And so generally, things weren't looking good for him. He was a Mississippi kite, which is about the size of a peregrine falcon, if anyone has seen those sorts of birds. And he's a raptor, like hawks or eagles or falcons.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're going to look at me.
Yeah.
I'll be back. Right there's another Mississippi kite. Okay, see ya. Bye. It just flew
overhead. Yeah. Well. Really, really pretty bird. But sadly for him, I guess, not on the endangered species list, not on anyone's conservation list. So the guy who worked for the Avian Research Center wasn't sure that we could find anybody who would even be willing to rehab him because he wasn't special. Isn't it sad not to be special? I thought he was special. So the phone calls started on Memorial Day. Again, on Memorial Day, the phone calls started trying to find a rehab person, and not just any rehab person. You can't just go to a rehab person. It has to be the correct rehab person. So we had to have a Raptor rehabber, and we had to have a Raptor rehabber on Memorial Day. Be able to get hold of that person, be able to get to that person. So we ended up finding somebody. We ended up finding somebody about 2 hours away from us. He agreed to meet us about halfway. So that's what we ended up doing after we coordinated the place and the time. And in the interim, this guy had felt like that we needed to immobilize that brake and immobilize the wing. If a lot of times if birds, if their feathers in general are not in really good shape, then they definitely won't get rehabbed because they don't think they're in good enough shape to try to rehab them, and they end up putting them down. So he asked who wanted to be the nurse, and my husband's like pointing at me, and I went over and got hold of the bird, and bless his heart, he was not only freaked out, but I'm sure this break was extremely painful. He asked me if I had vet wrap, and I'm thinking, of course, what person in the world doesn't have vet wrap? I'm sure everybody out there has got tons of vet wrap in your house, because that's just something that, just one of those things that I always keep. I have vet wrap, I have so many things for people and animals, bandages and just everything. So I went in the house, got the vet wrap, I'm holding on to this bird, and at one point this louse started to crawl up my arm, and I don't know if you have any idea if you've seen bird lice, but they're not lice like are on people. They don't bite, and they're huge, like a black grain of rice or bigger. I mean, they're good size. And this thing is walking up my arm, and this guy's looking at me like he's expecting that I'm just going to totally freak out. And I'm just thinking, okay, dude, just see it and knock it off my arm. And which is what he did. He knocked it off my arm, and it didn't really bother me, other than I was really kind of thinking I really didn't want him to go up my sleeve into my shirt, because I could get a little squirrely with having something crawling around in my shirt. But not a big deal. Not a big deal. We got his wing wrapped up next to his body, and got him placed in a box instead of the cage that we had put him in originally, so that he would settle down and so we could transport him. And then we jumped in the car and drove for a little over an hour, met a raptor, a licensed raptor rehabber, and relinquished the Mississippi Kite to the raptor rehabber, and I haven't tried to call him. I'm not really wanting to find out, I guess, that maybe he couldn't make it and that maybe they had to put him down. But likely he was injured. They're very aerial. Mississippi kites, kites in general, are very aerial. They spend most of their time in the air, and so the likely cause of his trauma was a power line. And just another indication of how much we do to the environment that is so detrimental to animals, to wildlife. Thankfully, we stopped using DDT a long, long time ago, and that's allowed many of these bird species to make real comebacks, but then we put all these other obstacles in their way. And so we need to continue to work on trying to figure out a way to all live together. Anyway, my Memorial Day spent, my husband, I'm so thankful for my husband. He knows how much I love animals. He loves animals also, and he's just so good to always support me and help me take care of these guys when we find them. We came across some horses several years ago, and there was one horse that was down already and quite sadly dead, and several of the other horses that were very poor. And my husband said, "You can't." I wanted to take pictures because I wanted to go to the county sheriff's office with the pictures. And he said, "You can't go on the property. It's private property. It's trespassing." Had it not been for him, I probably would have done it anyway. Again, it goes back to, I guess I'm lucky that I've had law enforcement attorneys in my life, people to either keep me from getting into trouble or people to get me out of it if I get into it. But he was adamant that I not trespass. And I wasn't crazy about the idea, but I really wanted to do something to try to help these horses before the rest of them died. And I ended up seeing a real estate sign adjacent to where I could take photographs. So we came home, I called the realtor, I asked for an appointment to go see that property, that I might be interested in buying it. And went on the property, got my photographs of the horses, and everything was legal. I didn't break the law. Good for me, huh? But I'm sure, you know, I'd like to know if you guys, what you think about that. I know laws are there for a reason. I know it's not a good thing to go around willy-nilly breaking them, but I don't know. Sometimes it just seems like the end justifies the means, I guess. I wanted to do a really quick review of, I'll take these glasses off so I can read. Laura Geller Waterproof Eye Spackle Advanced Eyeshadow Primer. This is in the color Fair Light. Comes in a box like this. Comes in a tube like this. Has a little twist bottom and a lid that's really tough to get off. And the little brush applicator that I'm not terribly crazy about, but really liked the product. Wasn't particularly happy with the paint pots because of the drying out issue and because of the old crayon smell. But so far as the value, this is not a huge quantity of primer. But I really do like it. It doesn't have any scent. It has a ton of coverage. If I can get a little out of it without getting too much out of it. That's why I'm really not a fan of these. But it does dry super, super, super fast. And this is Fair. It does dry super fast. So you really need to have the amount of product that you want to use on your the area you're going to put it on. And I could see actually even using this as a concealer, other than that it does have a very matte finish. But really love it. I don't know that it does what it purports to do, which is to make all your makeup that you apply on top of it waterproof. That's what it says it does. I haven't tested that out. But I do like it. I do like it as a primer. I think this is going to be my new primer. And you could use it. I think it definitely has enough coverage to use as a concealer, but again, it would be very matte coverage. Nothing illuminating, nothing highlighting about it at all. That's my review of the Laura Geller Waterproof Eye Spackle and my little Memorial Day story. And I really appreciate you watching. I hope everybody is having a great day, and I will see everybody real soon. Bye.